The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at WrestlingWithJonas.com.
Hello and welcome to the most recent edition. Why did I start like that? Welcome to the SWM podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. That is the worst intro done so far, but I've got a great guest for you. I am joined by one half of the new tag team No Holds Barred. I got to say it properly that time. It's Sean Martin. Welcome to the show.
It's actually really good to be here.
Thank you for being on. That was, yeah, that's the worst intro so far, but it's all good. I'm not even going to clip it out. Everyone needs to
recover. We'll recover. It's
fine. People need to know that I am flawed. So the first question is always the same. It's how did you get pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
We'll go for first and second. So the first time was I moved house from my old village. So I moved to a different village. And I started getting really friendly with my neighbour's grandkid, and he loved wrestling. So this is 2011. He loved wrestling. I'd never watched it. I never had access to it. And then I just sort of picked it up from there. Never really got into WWE until 2013. I was always an Impact kid. That's an Impact person, and then I sort of fell out of it around 2014, as a lot of people do when they sort of get that age. It's like, oh, it's what? And then 2016, just after Mania, I saw The Miz win the belt, the IC belt off a Ryder, the Raw after, and I was like, oh, that's a thing. And then it spiraled the moment I clicked on one, and then just the recommended just became PWG. And then you go into PWG, and then you're like, wrestling's actually kind of cool, isn't it? And then you end up in, as a mad indie kid in the, you know, the good old 2016, 2017 era of wrestling.
I was thinking, when you got into Impact, that's... Yeah, that is a fascinating time, because like 2010 was when Hogan came in. So you're
the people call the dark days, and I'm like, I kind of liked it. That's what I loved.
I mean, it's always a nostalgia thing, isn't it? Because when I started watching, it was, I mean, I'm unfortunately old enough to, when I started watching, it was 99. So I was like in the Attitude Era. So I'm in the parent cool time. But Evasion is like my preferred moments, 2001 onwards. I've automatically just felt so old, as I always do when you say it was 2011 to 2013 is where you started.
Yeah, that's when people go, oh, you're young, aren't you?
Yeah. So who were your first favourite wrestlers then? Who were the ones that kind of caught your eye the most?
At first, considering I was sort of mixed between WWE and Impact, at the start it was sort of Jeff Hardy. And then who else was it start? Like The Miz, it was sort of when he was starting to pick up steam after losing the belt, and also around that time I actually got to witness Sting. Not good Sting, Joker Sting.
Joker Sting was great. I loved it.
Joker Sting was great, and it's a great point, fact to point out that he was actually one of Flair's last matches, and Shawn Michaels wasn't his retirement match, and people get angry at me for that. It's worth it.
Oh no, I love Joker Sting. It was just fascinating. Jeff Hardy, another one name that always pops up on this podcast.
He's one of those ones that he's sort of the catalyst for a lot of people's careers, especially now. A lot of people go, he's kind of cool, isn't he?
I know, I think it was just, well, back in my day, he was the one with the dyed hair and tattoos and the tights. You'd always have to go and cut up your mum's tights to make you look cool. Oh. Well, you think you look cool, but reality, you're standing there in your living room with your mum's tights on your arms, and it's...
Look at me, I'm Jeff Hardy.
Look, Jeff Hardy. take my fingernails once, go, no, I don't know, made this far. I'll take off. That's fine.
Stop there.
Yeah, so, okay, so I'm just trying to get an age range of that time period there.
Yeah.
It's
a really weird period for me starting, especially when I started on Impact and people look at me and go, how did you like wrestling then?
And the fact that people don't correct you, go, oh, you mean TNA? Like, no.
I started
Impact.
It was that weird period of time where it wasn't just Impact and it wasn't just TNA, it was TNA Impact. And it was just chaos. No one knew what was happening. Not even Hogan did. He really does know.
So the wild days of Brooke Hogan and Bully Ray and Aces and Eights. That's your
Loved Aces and Eights. The greatest storyline for the first half anyway, then they revealed Bully Ray and it's just really downhill.
I don't know.
All of a sudden like Devon just disappears because he's contract disputes, half the members leave and they just slowly fizzle out. There's an awkward funeral scene.
I think if once they put in Wes Briscoe, their days were numbered. Oh, the funeral scene. Was Samoa Joe giving out everyone beers and then not giving
and Kurt Angle. And it goes to Kurt Angle and goes like, no, not you. I didn't understand that at the time. I had no idea why he went, no, not you. And then about 5 years later, I go, oh, that's why he said no. Oh, okay. That's
Right. So how did you go from that to deciding, oh, I'm going to try and be a wrestler?
So this jumps to 2016. I'm watching wrestling, and I think that's when WCPW started, which is another company a lot of people forget about. And I'm like, that was really cool. And then it sort of put a spotlight on British wrestling. So a lot of names came out, like Joseph Connors, Pete Dunne, and then the big ones, Joe Hendry, you know, all the Scottish lot. And then I think there was a show, BCW, I think, April... I try to remember the exact date, April 17th, I think it was. It was the one where they brought in Tatanka. And after that, one of the seats were a flyer for a PWE show. So one of the only other shows I went to was PWE. And I see another thing. It was a bunch of people who all trained at PBW. And I'm like, you know what? I live about 15 minutes away from the Barhead School. Let's go. I went one time and then I was like, you know what? This isn't so bad. And then I went back and then, you know, on and off for 2017 until I disappeared in about the November of that year. And then Respect opened up in 2018. That's where it really kicked off. That's the first journey.
I think people, WCPW, I didn't watch a lot of it. I think it's just more, I didn't have time or what right. have you. And I think it got a lot of hate. It got a lot of hate just because it was just like, they just plowed money into it and just bringing all these big names. But it was like it was on and the guys from Five Star Wrestling looked at it and went, ah.
Five star.
Oh, I love Five Star. I just for all the wrong reasons, but yeah,
there's
it's just
a skybox of a house with them on it. I think I've got all the Five Stars that were on TV recorded on a skybox somewhere in my house.
It's in
a cupboard somewhere. If I hunt it down, I'll find Five Star, and I'll be able to sit and rewatch all those glorious shows.
The funny thing is that they distributed the keys for the streaming so much that if you just do it on Facebook, they're on like the Herald or they're in weird places. I'll speak to Joe Hendry about it, which is a podcast I'll plug copious amount of times. But he was saying they pretty much just got, he wrote his own wrote a contract for them to sign and he got the streaming key and put it on his Twitch. So I've no idea how It lasted, what, 6 weeks?
How did they think they would make money? That's a genuine question. How did Five Star think they were going to make money after bringing in Rey Mysterio to an ice rink in the northeast of England? How do you possibly go, that'll make money?
I mean, they cut so many costs by not having music. It didn't have any music on the day of the show. Anyway, right, we don't want to make this a five-star wrestling podcast. No, if anyone wants to rate this five stars, then they're more than welcome.
We'll do a round table.
If we do the one like we did TNA with Jason Hyde, it'll just be an absolute riot. Right, okay, so you went to Respect, that's when you kind of picked up. But for your first couple sessions in PBW then, did you have an athletic background? Did you do any sports outside of wrestling?
No, I was very sort of inactive after when I started high school. Bad times, horrible times. And before that, in primary school, I played a lot of rugby, which for my size makes a lot of sense. But it resulted in a lot of problems, like a concussion at a very early age. That's not fun. I have jaw problems where my jaw now clicks because someone decided they were going to knee me in the jaw. That hurts a lot. Shoulder problems, which started my history of my right shoulder just giving up on me. So no athletic background whatsoever. That's... I always look at people with an athletic background and go, I hate you.
So all those problems, it was perfect to go into wrestling.
Yeah. That's the thing, though. By the time I got to wrestling, everything healed. Like, those all injuries happened in 2014. So it was a good 4 years, and I would hope that everything healed up, and everything did. And I just damaged my shoulder because I'm an idiot.
So PBW is, of course, Matt's is well established. That's where you started. Yeah. You didn't get a ring.
No.
I like to ask people, it's like if you're like hyped up to go into wrestling training, and then you go in and you just see Matt's, is your first thought, where's the ring?
No, not really. Well, for me, I sort of knew that PBW, no ring, because I sort of gathered it's a scout hall that they're renting. They're not exactly going to bring in a ring. No one would be stupid enough to have a community hall and build a ring every week. Oh, wait, hold on. Respect. I can say that. I was there. But I walked in, saw the mats, and I was like, right, okay. People crap on, like, training only being on mats. It's not as bad as people think. It's really good if you're doing basics. But when you're running, when you're doing a match and you have to run towards the ropes and then you go to run, but you don't follow the direction the mat's going, so you run across the mats and one of the mats decides to slide along the floor, so you end up half going into the splits, it really isn't fun. You sort of think, why am I doing this again?
Did you get to the point of getting to a ring before, or was your first experience when you went to Respect?
I never managed to get in a ring because I only got to help at two shows while my time there. PW Maximum Impact 2017, where I got kicked in the face. That's a great story. And then a BCW show. But I never had the time to actually get in the ring for one of the sessions for training, because I was too busy talking to other people. I was not a very good trainee. I'll say that. I will admit that. I was not a very good trainee there. I was sort of there, and I made too many friends. And I wanted to actually have dinner because I didn't eat that day. So I went over to a KFC crossing, a roundabout. Don't do it, kids. It's very dangerous. Because I wanted food before this show. So...
easily distracted is what I'm going for.
I was young, like I wasn't exactly the brightest of people. I'm still not the brightest. But I was not very attuned, and I never got in the ring until Respect.
So you said it was a good story, kick in the face. I would be doing myself an injustice
as a journalist.
How'd that happen?
Deserve this. So PPW Maximum Impact is the show just before Stevie won their title, and it was him versus BT Gunn. Now they decide they're going to brawl up to the stage. My first time security, I have no idea what's going on, and I see a bunch of people rushing round. So in my head, I'm going, why is everyone rushing round? And then someone grabs me and just goes, get ready. And I'm pushed into this massive crowd of black shirts at the back, and all I see is Stevie coming off the stage, and I'm looking up going, wait, what? We catch Stevie, go down. I stand back up, and somehow I've ended up near the front. And all of a sudden, just BT Gunn flies. He does a crossbody, and I just get smacked in the face. And as I go down, I go, I've just been kicked in the face by BT Gunn. Nice. That's only takeaway I have from that show.
So when you get to respect, I mean, I only did security for two shows, and I'm not trained, I'm not anything like that. I was just like a body. And
I was only security for two at PW, and how many did security did I do respect? I think I only done one at respect, actually. I've only ever done three security in my short time in wrestling.
It's one of those things where when I did it, I was just more terrified because I thought, I don't know what to do. If someone kicks off, I have no power to stop anyone.
You have no idea what's going on, like, especially when you're first. No one's gave you a rundown of, by the way, you might have to break up two wrestlers. No one's told you that. You're just meant to assume that, oh, I should probably break this up.
Oh, yeah, twice, but the first time it was in like Strathpeffer, and Jack Jester and who's against Tim Wiley, they went into the crowd, took apart the barrier, went into the crowd, and I was like,
As he does.
And I was like, okay, I'll put the barrier back together. That makes sense. Put the barrier back together. And I just saw Jester look at me. And I was like, I have done the wrong thing here. I just walked away. And I was just like, I'm going to stay as far away as possible for the rest of the match. Hopefully nobody kicks off because I'm not doing anything.
I hope I don't get kicked in the face.
That's pretty much it.
To your corner that you've been hiding in this entire time at a door.
I was already on edge because Noam Dar offered me a high five from the ring and I missed. And I was like, I hate this. This is the worst day ever.
Just stop at that point.
Went home. I just went, nah, I said, it's not worth it. It's not going to get any better than this. You went to respect. I have done my research.
The little research and the information that's out there about me.
It was difficult.
I don't put much out until recently.
So I was really just your Scottish Wrestling Discussion interview, which thankfully I took over onto the site because their website seems to have just disappeared a little bit.
Probably.
I've got the info though. So you went to respect. Your first day was with a little known wrestler who came from Source, by the name of Big Benny.
Oh, that wasn't my first one.
Was it not your first?
No. I, in respect, have months over Benny. I can say this. I'm the only trainee from the first 2 weeks at respect that's still there. Everyone else has had different reasons for stopping and stuff. So I was there in their second session. And Benny didn't appear till December of that year. 2018, yeah. Benny didn't appear till the 2018 December. So, Billy, get your facts straight, man.
Well, I mean, I'm working with very little.
I know. It's just going to be me telling you that actual stories behind things now.
That's absolutely fine. I think that's the point of the podcast, generally. It's just me asking the questions, you tell me the answers. Okay, so what was the reason for going to respect?
So, obviously, I lived closer at Barhead. But my way of getting there was my dad. Now, my dad passed away the year prior in 2017, halfway through me at PPW, which led to me leaving. So my gran would come down, but she lives in Drawson. Now, I disappear from PPW in about December. No thoughts of going back to training. And then around, I can't remember when they announced it, but about March maybe, Bobby announces Respect to open up to school, and it's in Lochwinnock. And I go, hold on, that's about 20 minutes away from my gran. And I was going down to my gran's for the weekends and stuff, so it just made more sense for me to go to Respect if I wanted to train, because she was down there already, I was already down there, may as well, and we'll see what happens. And then I can't leave. I'm stuck.
And so I was at that first session, and so you said you're the only one left of your...
of the first 2 weeks, I'm the only one left. And that makes me sad a bit, because I really did get along with a lot of the other people, but a lot of them just had to, like... In fact, hold on. No, that's a lie, actually. One person is coming back, I think, from those first couple of sessions. But everyone else is, as far as I know, is not...
So how was it then? Did you go in with a renewed focus to actually just knuckle down, or were you still kind of chatty?
I wasn't really chatty, because the thing with Respect is it wasn't as populated as PBW, especially the Barhead school. I would hear a lot of stories from people that were at Airdrie and Greenock, and it wasn't as populated. There wasn't as many people there. So when I went to Respect, there was not very many of us, which meant more time with the trainers and no one else my age, which left me feeling quite sort of alienated. But then I realised everyone's actually really nice and not big and scary adults. So yeah, it was sort of one of those ones I was like, you know what, like, let's just give it a shot, because I was there with wrestlers and I was like, oh, I really like you, so I'm going to try and impress you.
So it was kind of like you weren't with a bunch of mates. You were more like, oh, yeah. I'm here with grown-ups.
Yeah, I'm like a grown-up. I'm here with the big boys. Now it's like when you first walk into high school and you're like, oh, you're a lot scarier than I thought you were, because you look at the year above and you're like, oh, I remember when you were in P7, and then you look at them like, you're a lot scarier now. That's sort of the feeling.
I think about that so often that I think about, like, primary seven, I was tall. I was, yeah, like, I was taller than everyone else. And as soon as I went into secondary school, I was like, oh my God, how tall are you?
I look back now and I'm like, I don't remember being that small. I watched the first years walk past in the corridors. I'm like, there's no way I was that small. And then I go, hold on, no, we weren't. I swear, as the years have gone, the first years have gone smaller and smaller. There's no way.
Definitely, absolutely not. So then, of course, Respect then was the first time you hit the ropes, which I hear generally is two things. People, the normal people that say that it's the worst thing ever, and the couple nutters that just go, oh, it was fine, I want to do it again. So how were you in the first camp? Was it just...
I was in the second for quite a long time. I didn't mind it. The ropes were sort of like, it's a bit iffy, but it's not bad. And then eventually gets to the point where someone's like, right now, run. And you're running. That's about a year in. So I'm running. And I'm like, I keep running. And I go, I've been running for about 30 seconds now, non-stop. And you just hear, keep that pace up. And I'm like, okay. And then I go, I hate the ropes, I hate the ropes. Everything about this sucks. I don't like this. Let me leave, please.
I've misjudged my opening pace. I don't like this at all.
Because they always go, no, hit the ropes, full pace. And then you realise, when they say that, we're running for quite a while. They always say pace yourself, but then... when you're going too slow, it's like, right, I really should pick up the pace. And you pick up the pace, and you're like, I don't think my legs can move that fast.
So, wait, how long was it before you actually had your first match then from your time in
First respect? Match for Respect, right. I don't actually remember the first match, but I know who it was with. I know it was Benny. I can't remember when, but I know it's... No, was it June? think it was June of 2019. So over a year, because with respect, there was sort of a revolving door. Not many people were staying for long enough periods of time. And the very few that were, it was sort of like, we can't really, put them in a match that's not been long enough to actually have one. And then one day, Bobby just turns and looks at me and goes, go plan a match. So off we went into the little hall of the community annex and planned a match and then got back in, done the match, which one of my favourite matches to date is that match. And then taken down the ring, you three come here, calls over to me, Benny and Ruby Roberts. I think it was either the first match or second match we'd done, right? I don't know, but you get the story anyway, free of charge.
Cool.
And he goes, right, so we're going to do the showcase show. And then he tells us, me and Ruby, that we're going to be debuting for the first time. Benny's just going to get a fancy debut. Benny's just going to get a fancy one. That's what I love. Benny technically had already debuted, but we don't talk about it because this was his fancy one.
how fancy was his fancy?
It wasn't fancy, but it was more of a sort of proper one where I could sort of show that he was a respecter. Like before, he was just the former announcer that just kind of turned up in tights and decided he was going to have a match. So, yeah, it was sort of a more proper debut for him,
right?
Under the brand, so we could officially keep as a wrestler, not just have him randomly jump back and become an announcer again. Sorry, there's a tick out there.
I panicked when you said your debut match was against Big Benny because my research has it as Glenn Dunbar.
Oh, debut match was Glenn Dunbar. But first training match and first match was technically Benny.
Ah, right, okay. I'll just throw in Benny's comment just because this seems to be a good time to do it.
Oh, Big Benny famously named my running kick the GFK Experience, and I give him all credit for that because it set off this pattern of me naming most of my moves after assassinations.
And so when you do it, they go back to the left. Is that the kind of idea?
It's not that, it was just a running kick to the head. So he just turns around one day and goes, I've got a perfect name for it. I go, what? And he goes, the JFK Experience. And I'm like, I love it, it's mine. So that was the first move named after a presidential assassination.
So what have you got for Lincoln?
Oh, Lincoln, it's the Sean Wilkes Booth. It's a rolling elbow to the back of the head. Oh, trust me, some of the moves I've got planned and the names for them, it's a point where I'm like, I don't know if I can actually use that as a name because some people might get touchy over it.
I'm trying to think of any more. I saw two that come to mind, but I'm just like, right, okay, who would you offend though in Loch Winnie?
Oh, it's not that. It's like when people realise the name of the move and who it references, people will get sort of, it's like, I don't know if you can actually talk about that. There's an assassination. That's fine.
Are you bidding for the assassin, Sean Martin?
No. I just think it's funny to have all my names, most of my moves named after assassinations. Just to keep a theme, just keep it consistent.
Fair enough. So when I was speaking to Bobby, he was you're one of the names that he kind of pointed out.
I don't know why.
It was literally the names you gave yourself, Big Benny, and Ruby Roberts, yeah, as the three that he told me to kind of keep an eye on. So November 23rd, 2019,
This was the second match on a show. It was a pre-show match. It was myself and Stone Malone versus Big Benny and Jason Hyde. I was doing this match during the heat. I go crack, take a bump. I go, oh. For the second time that year, my shoulder decided, no. And I crawl over to Big Benny and I go, right, my shoulder's gone. And it's like, right, okay. And he's like, right, go home sequence. Both of us, hop tag, go, do the work. And I just roll to the outside and I lie in the floor going, get backstage. I say to Bobby, my shoulder hurts. And he goes, all right, go see Jayla Dark. And I waddle downstairs. I'm like, Jayla. She goes, what is that? And I'm like, I hurt my shoulder. She proceeds to go, you're an idiot. And I go, I know. I love her with all my heart.
She does come across as like,
she's terrifying, but she's one of the nicest people I know.
She's definitely got that mum energy. Me.
Oh, she does. It's terrifying. I'm scared of her more than I'm of mum. Like, that's, it's scary how much she, you know, puts fear into my heart.
So Tag of Stone Malone, Big Ben, Jason Hyde, another tick to my research. It's going well. So as you said, you had your match with Glenn DeBargain when I was reading up about you. He gave you a bit of advice. I just wanted to share it.
Just turns to me before his music hits. His big, sparkly, purple and gold jacket. Hair. And I'm sat there in my bright green tights and my lovely t-shirt. He turns to me and he goes, puts his hand out. I shake his hand and he goes, don't screw up. Turns around, music hits, and he's out of the curtain. I go, wait, what? I turn to ADM and I just go, what are you saying? He just goes, oh, and just walks away. That's a recurring theme with me and ADM. He just kind of goes, walks away after giving me feedback.
ADM, again, another one we've chatted to, and he does. He's just got that conscience kind of thing. He's always there. But you don't know
if I ever have moral dilemmas, I go to him, and I don't know why. Like, of all people, I could go to anyone else and I'd go, where's Darwin? Let's go see McGallum.
I could see him being like, he could give you a big, massive speech, so philosophical, and then you turn around and go, is that what you think? And you just go, nah. Just do what you want. Do what you want at the end of the day. I'm just here. Your final match before the world ended was on February 29th, Lethal Leap Year, which wasn't the name of the show, but I wish it was.
No, we should have named it that.
Just for the Southpaw Regional Wrestling throwback. It was against Mark J. Wilson, or who's now Austin Brooks.
I'll never call him that, probably. I'll just keep referring to him as Mark. You know, it's Austin now. I'm going, it's Mark. I don't care. Hard for me to change that because I've always referred to him as Mark. So it's like, why did you change it on me now? You couldn't have done it before the match.
And he threw out a little comment. He said, see, if you talk about how you beat him last year, he wasn't ready.
Well, technically, the ref turned to me and goes, Sean, are you ready? Then he turned to Mark, said, are you ready? And then Mark said, yeah, and the bell rung. So technically, he was ready. And he did make the first move. He did slap me first. So I returned.
So, yeah, so it sounds like, I mean, that was a verbal...
It was a verbal, ready up.
So I'll go through the fan questions because then we can kind of go a little bit wild and off topic. Jason Hyde's got, what exactly is the function of a rubber duck?
I'll be honest, even when I saw that question pop up, I've been sitting for days thinking about it. I have no idea. Is it a toy? Can you clean yourself with it? I'm not quite sure. And I feel like there's definitely an answer out there, but it's just too difficult to find. So, it's a toy?
Yourself and millions of Potterheads will have the same thought constantly. Old Arthur Weasley with the big questions, like
I don't know. I really don't know.
So we've got Shane. Oh, but hang on, I've got to get this wrong. It's Shea. Shia. Sorry. Yeah. I'm assuming just because I see a guy, I'm thinking Shane.
I sadly know these people because it's the Instagram ones. I know all these guys personally, well, apart from one of them.
There's one I'm regretting to ask, but I'll do it anyway.
I know the reference. I know the reference from him.
I think I do as well. But we've got Shea. He's asked, who's your motivation? With a big love heart.
Who's my motivation? I think my cat, to be honest. I'm finally getting him back. He's finally shown me love and affection again. So I feel like I'm doing something right.
What's the name of the cat? Is it a reference to something?
No, his name is JJ, and I'll always call him that. But when people go, is that his actual name? I go, technically, no. Technically, his name, because I named him when I was six, is Jedi Jacob.
Oh, that's amazing.
Because I loved Star Wars, and Mother loved Twilight. So we came up with JJ. So his name is Jedi Jacob.
I thought it was going to be Jeff Jarrett, but... Like,
the wrestling fan of me goes, I wish I called him Jeff Jarrett. But I had no idea who Jeff Jarrett was because his reign of terror in TNA just disappeared.
So it would have. Yeah, I think he would have came back briefly and then it was Global Force and he was selling gold.
Yeah.
As a
no, he's something. He's doing time. Something.
Yeah, something. He follows me on Twitter and every time I'm trying to get him on this for no other reason is he follows me on Twitter. So
be
like,
funny.
Oh, it'll be the worst thing ever. I'll be speaking to him and he'll be going, I have no idea what you're saying. And I'll be like...
Ask if you ever get him, ask him how he throws his punches. I'm really curious.
I'll bear that in mind. After I get him to do,
please do a
terrible rendition of With My Baby Tonight, which I don't know the words to, but good, because he doesn't either. So we've got Craig underscore CG. He asked... Well, he asked two questions.
He asked two, maybe. Yeah.
What was the deciding factor that made you want to pursue pro wrestling?
At the start, it was sort of, let's see if I can do this. Now it's sort of a curious thing of, can I actually do this? It's one of those ones I'm like, well, a lot of people are starting to pick up now. Like, British wrestling's got a spotlight on it for many reasons. But it's sort of been picked up as one of the more legit countries again. It's finally getting recognised, not just for world of sport. It's getting recognised for your progresses and all those big companies that are turning up now that are pushing out stars constantly. Like, you can't name one of the big promotions in the country that haven't got someone from one of their shows on a major company. You really can't. You look at Progress, and they've got literally all three of the world's biggest companies, WWE, AEW, New Japan, they've got someone in all of them. And the Scottish ones have got a grip on WWE, a real big grip on them right now. So it's more of a curious thing at this point. Like, can I? You know, we'll see.
Absolutely. I mean, at one point there was five Scottish champions in WWE,
yeah.
Which was just...
That was insane.
Just amazing. To think that we're a fairly small country in the grand scheme of things, but
yeah.
And we're putting out... And then you think about the other roster, was about 10, 15 Scottish wrestlers in major companies right now?
It's insane. When you think about the people that are in those companies and what their training was like, and you compare it to now, and you're like, well, if they can do it, what are the people that are training now going to do? You know, like Drew, you've heard stories, he was training the mats. What are the people from Source and Respect going to do, considering they've got rings? What sort of talent are they going to, you know, have in 10 years?
Absolutely. I mean, I've just got Drew's book, and I do remember, I haven't read it much of it as yet because I've attention span of a gnat. But I got TikTok, and it's become the worst thing for my attention span.
It's a horrible place to be. Just get off it as quick as you can. It sucks the life out of you.
I've got to see the guy's Aldi reviews, the tartan he buys.
And he gets really sad every time he eats an Aldi breakfast tin.
Yeah, that's it. It's like, why are you doing this to yourself? Stop it. And the way you microwave stack, like big stackers, rustlers, and oh no, it's a whole thing. Anyway, right, it uses the plastic. Anyway, right, so if Craig's also asked, if you could have been there live, assuming that he means there.
Yeah.
If you had any wrestling match in history, which one would it be and why?
See, I was thinking about that. It's difficult. It's like, what one would I really want to be there? And I was like, for the laugh it would give me, it would be Jeff Hardy Sting Victory Road. But the real fan of me wants to be at Mania 25 or 26, Taker Michaels. Right. Or, alternatively, Jericho Regal for Mania, because I'm a massive Regal mark. Love Regal.
Was that 18?
I think, because it was the cap off of sort of Regal's weird Raw spiel. After the whole pain of the cup thing, it was
that was a good time. I do remember that. Oh man, WrestleMania 18, 19, that 3 year stretch of WrestleManias and 20 actually were fantastic. And last one, we'll ask, is from Alfie. He's put Chad Ratitude as his Instagram name, which I love. So how much Lego can you stuff up your bum?
Dunno. I've never attempted it ever since I heard the question on the in-betweeners. I've never truly thought about it in depth. And I never thought on a wrestling podcast that would be asked.
There's part of me that wasn't
going to
ask it, but I thought...
Oh, honestly, it would have made no difference to the podcast if you didn't. But you've added it now, so that will forever be a question ingrained in the podcast's history.
To all the listeners, they're going to be sitting there going, how much Lego can?
All 10 of them that care about me.
Yeah, you're not far off my general audio numbers. So the two questions that I ask usually are stupid ones. Although I might add, I'm not going to add Lego one to my usual questions. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Favourite dinosaur? Brachiosaurus. Purely because of Power Rangers.
Oh, fair enough. I love it. Anyone that gives me a reason. If it's something that's not dinosaur related, even better. Two sheep versus one cow. Who wins?
Considering I live right next to farms, it would be a complete draw because both of them would just give up eventually.
Which would give up first?
Which would give up first? I think it'd be the cow because it'd just get born and just go lie down for a bit. And I've seen that before because two sheep once did actually get into the field next to me and I did watch two sheep chase around a cow for 10 minutes. It was highly entertaining.
So this is the first time I've actually had someone who's witnessed this matchup with that.
I've never seen a fight, but I have seen two sheep relentlessly chase a cow until it just gave up, and then the farm eventually sprinted out, realizing that two of his sheep had gone out.
Well, I'm glad that someone's actually witnessed this, and we're not this would happen. It's like, no, you've seen it. You know what happens. As far as wrestling goes, the last thing, of course, the world ended about 2 weeks after your final match. Not saying that they're related, but the wrestling stopped. What have you been doing in the interim between that?
So a lot of people say, well, wrestlers either jump to podcasts or Twitch. I just sat and spoke to really. Like at the time, decent friends. I was talking to a lot of people, just playing PlayStation because I'm still young, so I do not care. School had just decided we're just gonna roughly guess your grades, so you don't have to do a thing. So I was just like, cool, 5 weeks. Because if you remember, the first time they announced lockdown, it was like, it'll just be 5 weeks. So I'm like, right, that's a solid 4 weeks to play PlayStation with friends and a week to fix my sleep schedule. And then by the end of the fourth week, I'm like, yeah, we're just not getting out of this, are we? So it just became like working out, like, no physical change, but working out and playing PlayStation up until school decided. I was like, yeah, we're going to come back. And I'm like, why?
Yeah, but pretty much... You're exactly right with not just wrestlers, but just everyone.
Yeah, a lot of people just sort of jump ship. It's like, oh, let's do a podcast.
you do Twitch or podcast. I tried Twitch, and then, like I've said many times, a lot of people that I created, I could not use anymore. So I did a podcast instead, and here we are coming up to 10 months later, and I'm still inexplicably doing a podcast for whatever reason. This is my social interaction. This is it now. This is all I do.
Perfectly fine.
That's fine. It's an hour, and if we don't like each other, one of us can leave the conversation, and it's all good.
Exactly.
It's the best way. So I've also noticed you've also partaken in the Liu Kang Sharp online dojo.
Yeah, that was really good for the classes I've attended so far. That was brilliant when he just turns around and goes, "You know, I'm going to start this thing up," and I join, and it's the whole lesson. I'm like, "This is really good." I've actually got my book over there. Like the first three pages are just of the first class, and then there's a cry run. Then I got invited to a couple other seminars by other people, so I've just got this book, and it's like fairly, you know, a decent amount of pages have been filled with just seminars. So it's.
Have you and the bigger guests like your Bull James and your Selena Del Rey, have you been getting into them?
I was at the Selena one, and I was at the Buffa one. Never managed for Bill James. I think I might be going to the Doug Williams one. Not sure. We'll know probably by the time of this out that if I went or not. But yeah, I managed to make Buffa and Selena's, which were really good.
Lou is just. Of course, he's now one of the trainers or helping out at Respect.
GM of a human being. I love that man.
And he's got just the biggest black book of contacts and networks.
Oh, it's great.
It's ridiculous. He's just a guy who just when I say no without getting an email address, it seems to be, it's like, I'll get feedback from you one way or another.
I'm leaving here with your email address. You don't have a choice.
But no, I attended the Krieger one because it was
it was a really good one.
I'm just like, I attend that because it was free, because I was like, I paid £10 for something that I'm not going to use.
Yeah, you're not exactly a wrestler, so it's like, well,
exactly.
The free ones, the ones that are more sort of general, it's like a wide net just being cast over you. That's what the free ones are that I've seen.
Absolutely. So I'm hoping to, if Lou decides to do like his once a month ones of them sell, that I might just jump into them, because I'll probably find them fascinating to listen to and watch. Right, okay. So, other thing I know that you've been doing, because again, cyber stalked you a little bit. You're getting into photography a little bit as well.
Yeah, that's sort of one that I started halfway through lockdown, and I thought it'll be a great idea to do it at school. I'll take this on as one of my subjects. Boy, oh boy, did I regret that, and I hate the existence of photography. Can I ask roughly when will this be out? Because that lets me know how much I can see.
If people want to pay for it, it'll go out tomorrow. But which is on our Patreon.
That's fine.
May 13th is when it's due to go out.
May 13th. Right, I'm still in school, so I can't say much. Okay, right. It just limits me in what I can say. Bad about the school. You should have scheduled me later. That would have been... great.
I'm planning to end it on May 19th this run.
Sean Martin shoots in his school.
whoa, we can't put that in any. That is not the headline. We can't have that come out of it.
Yeah, we can't. It'll get clicks. It's fine, Billy. Clickbait, it's fine. It's fine, Billy. Anything for money. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So we'll take it back to a lighter subject. I did photography in school. And so for my folio, they were like, "What do you want to do?" And I was like, "I could do sort of still life. I can sit and stare at a glass cup or whatever for an hour and take 100 photos of that. Or I could use my very good connections to do a wrestling folio." So when I sort of leave, I plan on sending the photos to the person saying, "Listen, would you mind if we sort of... we can use, you can have these, you can sell them wherever." But I would start doing my folio for that, so all my shoots with DCT. I got about three done, and then around December they were like, "You can't even go outside your house," and I'm like, cool. So that just kind of screwed me over. But luckily, I had photos that I'd just randomly taken about the gym while I was in there doing a one-to-one with Bobby one time. And he had to, you know, go to a phone call, and he was like, listen, just, you know, sit for 10 minutes, and it turned into a half an hour phone call. So I just got my camera and I started taking photos of like the ring. So I was so glad I got a bunch of photos for that. So photography, yes. It's now an interest that I despise.
So yeah, so a quick turnaround then. You went from going, yes, I'm going to do this, to...
Yeah, I hate this living existence because making me analyse this photo, I don't want to do this anymore.
The fact that analysing makes me laugh because often people just do it because they're doing it. There's no underlying meaning or message or arrangement. That's, I picked up a camera.
That's what we call my folio. Especially for wrestling. Like I feel so much respect for, even before I've done this, for the guys like David Wilson, Marion McGinn, who does a lot of photos, and all the people who do wrestling photography, because that's difficult. Oh my, that's very difficult to do. It's not easy. And claps for them, please, because they're difficult shots to get. Like the shots you get, like, yeah, I think it's Daz Black's one where he's mid shooting star. That's extremely difficult. You don't realize how difficult it is until you're looking at the camera going, that's blurry. Right, that's out of focus.
I think it describes all the photos I've ever taken at a wrestling show.
It's not an easy thing to do.
Absolutely not.
It's really not.
And as far as wrestling goes in the future, of course, Respect will be where you'd be hoping to apply your trade, but also you're announced for Pro 2 Wrestling.
Yeah.
With Eli Bulwark as part of No Holds Barred. Yes.
And all credit to him for the name. All credit to Eli for the name.
I would have thought so because his look being a bouncer kind of thing. How did that come about? Because I know that Logan Storm is very much an ideas guy. If he's got you on his roster, he's got an idea for you. So did you approach him? Did he approach you? How did that go?
So I intended on approaching Logan around sort of January time when sort of Proto, I seen sort of Bobby and all that getting announced. I was like, right, I really should send a CV over to him. But I kept getting distracted by a lot of schoolwork because at this point it was just online. So I had no time at all. And I just get a message one night from him on Facebook, and it's like, adios, mate. Not adios. What's the Spanish? Hola, is it? I don't know. Right. Whatever it was, right? And he's like, just wondering when you're going to send me this email. I explained to him, listen, I've just been extremely busy. I will send one over soon. He's like, just fire one in right now. So I fire a quick one, and he's like, cool. Don't hear back from him for about a week or two. He just goes, right, cool, you're going to be on the shows. I'm like, sweet, nice, done that, woo, go me. And he was like, I'll probably use you in the Joker division. I'm like, all right, sweet. Next day, I'm like, how do you feel about doing a tag team? I'm like, if it's with the right guy, sure. And I was like, cool, well, I'll just get a grip with them. And then I get a grip with Eli. And then he's like, I want you to sort of do this tag thing. And I'm like, all right. Okay. And he was like, yeah, just think of a name so I can announce you. And I'm away thinking of names to no avail. And I all of a sudden I checked my phone, it's just a message from Eli saying, what about No Holds Barred? Because honestly, he's a big security guard and I like technical. I like putting you in a wrist lock and holding it for as long as I can to avoid doing anything else. So it's sort of a the way we're looking at it is a sort of Heart Foundation style team. I do all the technical, and he comes in and just hits people, and I sit back and laugh.
So, will you try and go for the matching gear then, both you and the black?
Hopefully, gear? I don't know. I'm going to stick with my bright green, not the bright green tights, because I'll be honest, I hate those. I hate those things. I hate those with a passion. I want rid of them as quick as possible. But I don't have enough money to buy new gear, so I'm stuck with them for the time being.
How did you get them?
So, we got them from this dancewear shop. Now, when they took my measurements, I was considerably bigger. By the time, right, so I ordered them in about August, right, of 2019. And then I don't hear anything after sending them the original design for my tights for months. And it comes up to the 2 weeks before the debut. I mentioned, I'm like, hey, any word in the progress about my tights? And they go, oh, we've ran into some issues. And then proceed to tell me that they will not be able to execute my original design. And I'm like, just figure out, I really do need them for the 29th or 27th. I think it's 27th. And I get them the Wednesday before the week of the show. I get them the Wednesday. The show's on the Sunday. I try these on. And I just look down and they slip. And I go, huh. That's a problem. They're also a lot greener than I remember picking. So Saturday, I turn up, I'm at respect, and Bobby's like, right, put them on, you know, get in the ring, test them out in the ring. And they keep slipping. And just really, Robinson appears and goes, do you want me to sew them tighter? And I'm like, yeah. So I go get changed, put them on my normal shorts. And she sews, like, before the show on the Sunday, into my tights, like a gap, like a, sort of folds it at the back, makes it a bit tighter. It didn't help at all. They're still too loose. So there's only one video of my match out there, and constantly throughout the match, I'm pulling these tights up. They do not fit. They're not flattering at all. And I had to wrestle two more matches after that with them on. And I'm hoping by the time shows come back, I have better things. I have better ideas. Don't involve me looking like the 60s Riddler.
So it would be green. Was that was there a particular reason why you chose green for the gear?
It was at the point no one had really bright green gear. So I ordered bright green gear. I also, no loyalty, but was a massive Celtic supporter in my youth, mostly because it annoyed my dad. So I was like, you know what, let's go with the green. And green's always been a sort of constant part of my life. So green just happened to be the one I chose because I always got told, don't do black. Just don't do black. And I'm looking at everyone going, I'll do green. Worst mistake of my life. But now I'm determined to keep the green around. So that's the only thing that stays.
Yeah, I mean, I was looking at, because of course, again, I do these research things, and I was looking at the gear, and I was thinking, that's half a green. That's
it's very
it's
green.
It stands
it's
out.
It's bold. It's a bold choice.
That's what we'll call it. That's the way to put it. Bold.
It's a bold choice, not the choice I made, but a bold one at that.
It's fine. Just get Eli to just put a bit of green on. I was going to say wear a green shirt, but no, that's not helping the Riddler thing.
I have plans to not have as bright green gear and sort of mix in another colour so that I don't look as bright green, and then I'm slowly working out a sketch of a logo that incorporates sort of me and him into that we can use.
Cool, so big things planned when it comes to No Holds Barred.
Very big.
Awesome. Right, so what else have you been up to during lockdown then? I've written down WandaVision. I don't know, have you been into the MCU shows?
The one tweet I made about MCU shows and got no interaction. Yeah, I love Marvel. And when WandaVision first dropped, I watched the first two episodes. I was sat there like, I want more. And then I had to wait a week for it. And then I really enjoyed it. And then it stopped. And I was like, oh. And then Falcon and Winter Soldier started. And I was like, yay. And then that's just stopped. And now I'm sad again. Because nothing's coming out for another week.
We wait for over a month now for Loki, which I don't know how. I've watched Falcon and Winter Soldier twice now through, because I had to.
It's for the Zemo dance, isn't it? It's all for Zemo.
A little bit for the Zemo dance, and my wife has developed a humongous crush on Bucky Barnes.
Fair enough. Don't
worry. I mean, I can't do anything about that. I can't look like him. I do have metal in my arm, but it's not quite the same.
It's not the strongest metal on earth, is it?
It's definitely not. I bang into a door in my elbow, and that's me out of action for about an hour. I'm done. It's two plates, and that, I guess now that's it. It's same nice. Vibranium. No. Although what it has done is I've suggested getting a Captain America shield to hang into in our lobby, and it's getting closer and closer now that she likes this. Like yes, it'll join. I mean, as soon as I get it, I will be hanging about with this thing and the shield constantly forever. So anyone watching this,
that'll be great.
Oh, there'll be so many pictures, and it's...
I can't wait. I'll wait.
Between that and my array of wrestling belts, I'll just be the biggest mark, as they'll call them call us on the interweb, because...
Oh.
Terrible. Oh. But no, I didn't notice the WandaVision tweet. I read these things. The other thing was a picture of Pokemon, which I did mention before we hit recording. You said you have a very limited knowledge of it.
I barely know anything about Pokemon. I know barely anything about Pokemon. But I started spray painting art, and I had leftover red and white and stuff. And I was like, you know what, I'm going to finish out these cans one way I know. So I'd done a massive Pokeball on this pallet of wood I've got, and I've got nailed into it two boards from an old chest of drawers, and it just sits out front of my house. And I've got a massive piece of chipboard on it, the like sort of corner before you turn around, that just gets spray painted every other week. I just change the design on it. So that's
it's super cool. So it's art. You say you do photography has become a hate passion of yours, but yes. Have you always been quite artistic and creative?
I've always been artistic. Never been good at it. Never really been good at it, but I've always sort of been drawn to creative stuff. Like, I actually got some of my sort of, if you've ever seen them, like the people on the street, they go out with spray paint and they do like the planets and stuff. I decided in February, I was like, you know what, let's give it a shot. And then I've done so many. I've got like way too many of them. Like Amazon, like one of the thin like cardboard things filled with like photo paper covered in planets and stuff, and really nice ones. If I hold on, it's next to me. I'll call a couple out for you. Just keep talking, Ben. Just keep talking.
So is this guy, because you said you're doing the designs for your logo for yourself and No Holds Barred, so are you going to bring in the space element to it, or is it just going to be
big scary dudes? I'm just doing a sketch, and I'm going to send it off to someone that knows what they're doing. So this is one of the pieces, one of my favourite ones.
Nice. I don't know why I squinted. It's the screen.
Star Vader one, which I was very proud of when I finished it. That's one of the best ones. Just a massive Darth Vader one.
Awesome. Well, I mean, you say your hate passion for photography, but you seem to be trying to pick up things to keep yourself occupied during this time.
Keep myself occupied, because we don't know when wrestling's come back, and I've never thought I'd say this. I miss throwing my body at things. I miss throwing my body at a big metal structure with wood on it and some padding.
So let's look to the future then to round this off. So as of recording, things are opening up again. When it comes out, everything could be shut again for all we know. But fingers crossed, knock wood and all that. What's your goals? What is your immediate? Do you have an immediate goal in mind, or what's your big dream? Favorite opponents you want to face? Just give me everything.
Right. So, opponents I want to face, this is purely because of very recently, in the past couple of months, I really want to, you've probably seen Effie has become a recent, very much opponent of mine. I'm like, I really want to get in the ring with you. because I just feel that'd just be incredible. Tyler Bateman is another one. Bateman from sort of Ring of Honor and now New Japan, who's very much been a massive influence. I'm going for the sort of worldwide names because Scotland will probably end up wrestling everybody.
Absolutely, and plus wrestling nowadays it's still a small circle. There's every chance. I would absolutely say that if once things open up again, Effie would be doing a UK tour.
Oh, Effie said, I've been in his Twitch streams, and he said, the moment that he's able to, he is doing a UK brunch, and I'm like, I'm gonna work so hard to get on that. Or even just be near it and help out, because I want to meet him and I want to get in a ring with him. Because it'd just be so much fun. The guy is insanely talented. And the fact that people are only picking up sort of the past year about him, myself included, is sort of like, why did we not know about you before? You're really good.
Anyone else?
Going along the lines of Bateman, Vincent, who's just sort of came off his thing with Matt Taven. Love Vincent. Dalton Castle, most of Ring of Honor's roster. I'll just cut myself there. Most of Ring of Honor. That's a huge company for me, is Ring of Honor. It'd be great to work.
So it's like a kind of goal would be to try and get onto the Honor United stuff when it comes to
I've always said getting on Ring of Honor would be massive for me, and if that's where I stopped, I'll put my hands up and say that's it. If I manage to get to Ring of Honor, I'll just be like, okay, I'm doing this. Okay, go, nice. Freaking out backstage.
And that's the thing, again, it's not outside the realms of possibility. Joe Hendry, it's, Martina,
yeah,
they're all over there just now. You mentioned Vincent in your I don't watch Ring of Honor, so that I was automatically confused when you put Vincent. Yeah. I was thinking, Virgil, you want to face Virgil when he was in the NWO?
Oh yeah,
that's
of course.
A very weird choice of a bit. I mean, I don't know what you like. So.
If we want obscure wrestling matches, that be, I want a match against Paul Burchill if he ever decides he's getting back in the ring. I want
with the
that
pirate gimmick.
Either with the pirate gimmick or the Ripper, I don't care. I want to wrestle him. It became a running joke of how much I love Paul Burchill in the past year, because it sort of spilled out in wrestling quizzes how much I love Paul Burchill. The man deserves so much more.
I don't. He seems like the kind of guy Luke could get a hold of for a online dojo. I know when he puts up the post for it, everyone goes,
I'm going to message him probably after this to say, is there any chance you could get Paul Burchill in the seminar?
Somebody.
He probably does.
Maybe knows Luke King Sharp. No, Luke Sharp knows Joe Hendry. Joe Hendry knows Katie Lee.
I know Joe Hendry. It's fine.
That's good. Him.
Just cut out the middleman. Sorry, Lou, you don't get money. I'm going straight to Joe Hendry.
When I spoke to Joe, it was like very scary because, well, actually, he's so nice, but he's so professional.
He's so intimidating. I remember meeting him when he turned up to Respect. And me and Benny shake hands. Benny, of course, knows him, right? He trained with him at Source. And I'm just shaking his hand like, well, you're a lot taller. And then he turns up on the show and me and Benny, I wish that show got filmed. Me and Benny are in the corner howling. And I'm just throwing Jonathan Richards about. Like, just me and him laughing in the corner, watching this go down. We didn't get in the ring. We didn't get a chance. We were just sitting watching this happen. It was a massacre. And then Joe Hendry just shakes her hand, gets out of the ring, leaves.
But when I was interviewing him, I sent you the link to Zoom, because that's how I've been doing it. Just it's easy. But I thought, I'm speaking to Joe, I'll send him an invite to a meeting I set up. Oh, clever. I didn't know how to get into the meeting when they set up. And he emailed me 10 minutes when I was arranged before, going, I'm in the meeting room. Is this interview still happening? And I was like, I don't know how to get into this meeting. From the 40-minute interview that we had, it could have been an hour. However, it took me 20 minutes to actually get into the meeting room to speak to him, the one that I had set up myself.
That's amazing.
So from now on, if anyone asks me to do an interview, I'll be sending them the link at the time I'm ready. That's the easiest way to go. Right, so your big dream then will be Ring of Honor.
Yeah. Ring of Honor, AEW, all that sort of spiel.
Get Daniel Bryan when he eventually goes back on the indies.
I don't think I'll ever get a chance with him. He said himself he won't be wrestling for longer, and I'm just like, but why? Being that whiny little indie wrestler, it's like, well, he'll definitely face me in my little tiny countryside town of North Ayrshire. Wrestle me in front of 100 people. I'll retire him in the Walker Hall and
Contour or something in there.
I'll retire him in the Magnum and Northern.
It could happen. It could happen. But great. I think I've covered everything that I've wanted to cover during this interview. But before we turn this into just speaking about absolute nonsense about Five Star and what have you. Where can people find you on social media?
Everything, as far as I know, is Sean MPW, Facebook Sean Martin on Wrestling. TikTok, if you really want it, is LSMOGC. I keep forgetting that because I'm technically a Lord of Glencoe, and I put that as my TikTok thing, and I keep forgetting how to say that. So it's
Sorry, hang on. You've come this far. You're technically a Lord of
Glencoe. For my birthday this year, I got gifted land in Glencoe. Like, you know, one of those conservation things where it means you technically can call yourself a lord.
Right, okay.
There's even a card. I'll need to cover the back half of it because I don't want people finding my shoot name or my plot of land. But,
I don't want your plot of land. Fair enough.
So, for all we know, when I come back, it might be Lord Sean Martin Wrestling.
There's not enough regal characters in pro wrestling.
There's not, and I'll rival Paul Tracy.
Absolutely. But technically I'm a reverend for the Universal Life Church, so I could be Reverend Billy.
I'll just leave them, Billy. Just fine, just one up there then.
Yeah, just I could marry people. If we get a third person in. Before you knew it, there's a third person coming to the chat now. But yeah, it's I've never used it because I don't know if it's legal here.
That's power that no man should have.
Definitely not. I'm just going past people going, I now pronounce you man and wife. I now pronounce you man and man. I now pronounce you wife and wife.
I'd do that. At a random wrestling show.
Oh, amazing. I can do that. Teddy Biasi can do it. I can do it. Right, okay. We've gone off the rails here as we end the show. But thank you for joining me today.
No problem. We'll leave some topics for a potential second episode because there's enough that I've got that we could fill another episode with in season 7. We'll go for 7.
We'll do another episode. You can... how could we put this without making it sound like it's a crime? You can... wax lyrical about your school.
Yes. Yeah, we'll get loads of stories about that and how a teacher told me I was going to fail to my face. So
that was good. Anyway, yeah, we'll leave that for our time. But again,
that's great.
Thank you for joining me today.
No problem. Anytime.